I am Sunita from Department of Computer Science, Vignan Degree College. In this video, I am going to discuss about inheritance in Java, which is a part of third unit. In this inheritance, there are various topics, inheritance and its types. The second one is access modifiers, and the third one is access specifiers. First, we will discuss about inheritance and its types. First of all, what is the definition of inheritance? An inheritance is the mechanism of deriving a new class from the already existing class. And this thing is referred as inheritance. Here, the old class is also called as base class or parent class or super class. And the new class is also called as derived class or subclass or child class. Here, in this inheritance, the main advantage is reusability. We can achieve reusability if we implement the inheritance. Because from the already existing class, we are creating the new classes without writing the new classes entirely. So, inheritances, the first one is single inheritance, second one is multiple inheritance, third one is hierarchical inheritance, fourth one is multi-level inheritance, and the last one is hybrid inheritance. Now we will see the diagrammatic representations of inheritances. The first one is single inheritance. In this inheritance, from a single parent class, we are deriving a single child class. Next, moving on to multiple inheritance. In multiple inheritance, from two or more parent classes, we can derive a single child class. And the third one is multi-level inheritance. In this inheritance, from a single parent class, a new child class has been derived, which is child 1. And from this child class, another child class has been derived, which is child 1-1. So we can derive any number of levels, that is any number of child classes from the single base class. So many levels have been created here. And so it is referred as multi-level inheritance. And next, moving on to the fourth one. In this inheritance, from the single parent class, we can derive two or more child classes. This inheritance is referred as hierarchical inheritance. And the last one is hybrid inheritance. Hybrid inheritance is a combination of any two types of inheritances. For example, it can be a combination of single and multiple inheritance, or it can be a combination of multiple and multi-level inheritance. So in this slide, we are going to know the syntax of the single inheritance. The syntax for the single inheritance will be like this: class, subclass name, extends superclass name, and within the class, we have to declare the variables and the methods. Here, the keyword extends have to be written after the subclass name. The extends keyword specifies that all the inherited properties can be present within this class. So finally, the subclass will contain all the inherited properties as well as its own properties. That is, it will contain all the inherited members as well as its own members. Regarding single inheritance, in this inheritance, there are three classes. The first class is room. It is having two variables, namely len and bre of type int. Next, there is a method room whose return type is void, and it is taking two parameters, namely L and B. And within the body, the value of L has been stored in len and the value of B has been stored in bre. Finally, the method has been closed and the class also has been closed. Next, moving on to the second class, that is the subclass. And the name of the subclass is room new. So we are writing the class header like this: class room new extends room. Since extends room, all the properties of room will be inherited into this particular class. Now room new is having its own method, and it is int area. Within the body, we have multiplied the value of len and bre. Finally, the method has been closed and the class also has been closed. Next, moving on to the main class, it is main room. The name of the main class is main room, and within this main class, main method has been written. And within this main method, we have to create object for the class room new, because room new holds the entire things. So object has to be created for room new, and the name of the object is R. With this object, we are calling the room method with two values, namely 20 and 30. So upon executing the statement R.room of 20, 30, for the object R, len will be holding 20 and bre will be holding 30. Next statement is r.area of object r. So area method will be invoked, and the value of LAN and BRE will be multiplied, which are present in the object R. So 20 into 30 gets multiplied and 600 will be stored in the variable area. So finally, the area value will be printed here, which is 600. So the output for this entire program will be 600. Multi-level inheritance. Multi-level inheritance means we can create any number of levels. That is, we can create any number of child classes. So initial class name is capital A, class capital A. Body has been written within curly braces. The next child class is class capital B extends A. Since extends A has been written, B will be holding all the properties of A and its own properties. Finally, the third class is class capital C extends B. So since we have written extends B, all the properties that are present in B will be inherited into C, and C will have its own variables and methods. So all the entire information is present in the class capital C. Next, moving on to the second topic, which is access modifiers. In this Java language, there are three important access modifiers. The first one is static, the second one is final, and the third one is abstract. Before going on to know what is static, first we will see what are instance variables and instance methods. Instance variables and instance methods are those that belong to each object. That is, a copy of each of them will be stored in each and every object. So they are referred as instance variables and instance methods. Since you are residing in each and every object, we have to invoke them by using the help of object name. Whereas now a new keyword static has been introduced. So static defines static members. Static members are also called as class members. That means static keyword can be used to define the variables as well as methods. Static variables and static methods are class variables and class methods. They belong to the class. They does not belong to any object. They does not reside in any object also. So we need not take the help of object in order to invoke them. And here is an example related to static variables. Here the name of the class is statVAR. In this example, there is a variable X which is holding the value 10 and it is an instance variable. So it will be a copy of this X will be present in each and every object. So X is an instance variable. And Y is a variable which is a static variable and it is holding the value 20. Since it is a static variable, it will be present within the class. It does not belong to any object. And after these two variable declarations, main method has been written. And within the main method, initially we are printing the value of Y directly without taking the help of any object. So system.out.println Y has been written. Because Y is a static variable, we need not take the help of any object. And next, in order to print X, first I am creating an object for the existing class and the name of the object is S. And if we want to print the value of X, we have to write the print statement like this. System.out.println S.x. Since X is an instance variable, we have to take the help of object and dot operator in order to print it. So Y can be printed directly, whereas X can be printed by taking the help of object. So the output for this program will be 20, and in the next line, 10 will be displayed. Now moving on to the second access modifier, which is final. This final keyword can be applied either to a variable or a method or to a class. For example, if the final keyword is used for the variable, then that particular variable will be treated as a constant. And if the final keyword is applied before a method, then that particular method cannot be overrided. That is, we cannot create the same method in the subclass. And for example, if the keyword final is placed before the class, then that class cannot be subclassed. And here is an example related to the final. In this example, we are demonstrating a program regarding the final method. Here the name of the first class is capital A and it is having a show method which is declared as final. And within the body, we have written a print statement which is welcome class capital A. the method has been closed and the class also has been closed. So capital A is the first class which is holding a final method, and the name of the second class is capital B. So class capital B extends A. Here we are implementing inheritance, so all the properties of capital A will be inherited into capital B, and it is now having its own method void show, and a print statement has been written within this. Finally, the method and the class also has been closed. So finally, two classes have been completed, and next the third class name is mfin, which is main class, and within this main class main method has been written, and within this main method initially for the class capital A an object has been created, and the object name is obj1. So obj1.show means the first show method that is present in the class capital A will be invoked and the output will be printed. Next, in the next statement, I am creating an object for the class capital B, and the name of the object is obj2. Show means, since capital B is having two methods, final method and a normal method, and we should not override the final method, so compile time error will be displayed if we write this particular statement. That is, an error will be displayed if we execute the statement obj2.showoff. And next, moving on to the abstract, which is the third access modifier. An abstract method is a method that does not have any body, that is no body should be written within the abstract method, and since no body is written, it should end with a semicolon. Semicolon should be placed at the last of abstract method. An abstract method generally contains its own syntax. First, the keyword abstract, followed by the return type, next the method name, next the list of parameters enclosed in parentheses. Generally, abstract methods are written within the superclass, and an abstract method should be overrided in the subclass. That is, we have to provide the body of the abstract method in the subclass. That is a rule that has to be followed for the abstract methods. And any class that is containing the abstract methods is called as abstract class. And for the abstract class, it is a rule that we cannot create the objects. So no objects can be created for the abstract classes. And here is an example for abstract methods, its own print statement. Finally, the method has been closed and the first class also has been closed. Here in this first class, since abstract method has been written, the class should be declared as abstract. So the keyword abstract is placed before the class name. And next, moving on to the second class, the name of the second class is AVS class, and it is extending the first class, extends abstract EX. That is, all the properties that are present in the first class will be derived into this new class. That is, all the properties will be inherited into AVS class. Now AVS class is having a display method. The statement that has been written here is system.out.println code for abstract method. Finally, the method has been closed, and after closing this method, main method has been written, which is public static void main string args. And within this main method, we are creating an object for our class. That is, we are creating an object for the second class, ABS class. AB is equal to new ABS class of. So the object that has been created for this class is AB. Now by using this object, initially the display method has been invoked, and the calculate method also has been invoked. So the results will be printed based on the calling. The main thing that we have to remember is abstract methods are generally present in the superclass, and they does not have any body, and they should be overrided in the subclass. And any class that is containing abstract methods should be treated as an abstract class. And finally, moving on to the access specifiers. In Java, there are three types of access specifiers, or visibility controls or access controls, in order to restrict access for the variables and methods. Here are the three visibility controls. The first one is public, the second one is private, and the third one is protected. Public means the variables and methods can be accessed by any class. That is, no restriction is provided for the variables and methods. Anyone, any class can access these variables and methods. Private access specifies that the variables and methods should be accessed only within that particular class. They cannot be accessed even by subclasses also. So Private means highest restriction or highest protection is provided for the data and methods. And the last one is protected. Protected means the variables and methods can be accessed within that particular class as well as for the subclasses also. And those subclasses can be present in the same package or in the different packages. So protected means the own class can access it as well as its children also can access that particular members. That is regarding the protected. And all these topics are covered in this inheritance.